como el aire libre, no más se pasa volando. Ser como la paloma también se pasa volando. Cuando yo era chico, mi madrecita decía: cuídate, mi mijito, no te me metas en líos. Ser como el aire libre, no más se pasa volando. Ser como la paloma también se pasa volando.
Good evening, and thank you so much for coming tonight to hear artists Enrique Lugo, Chikle, and Lalo Alcaraz. My name is Alessandra Moctezuma, and I'm the gallery director here at San Diego Mesa College. And I was very excited about this exhibition. We have been planning it for a long time. One of the ideas was to feature trailblazing artists, Chicano artists, Latino artists, that are using visual satire to talk about social issues. And many of these artists follow in the tradition of the Chicano artists from the movement of the 1960s and 70s. The exhibit features Favianna Rodriguez, Melanie Cervantes, and Jesus Barraza, who are in the Bay Area, so they couldn't be here tonight. And Lalo Alcaraz lives in Los Angeles, and Chikle is local here in San Diego. This exhibition was curated in collaboration with Professor Cesar Lopez from our Chicano Studies Department. He introduced me to the work of Jesus Barraza and Favianna Rodriguez, and so I was thankful because it made a really wonderful mix of artistic styles. If you know the history of political graphics, the work of Favianna and Melanie and Jesus follows very much in the tradition of Bay Area artists like Malaquias Montoya and Rupert Garcia. And then we have Chikle, who uses the materials that are available to him. He prints on cardboard, and he also comes from a tradition of street art, and so I like also that aspect of it. And I called Lalo Alcaraz a modern-day José Guadalupe Posada, because like Posada, he responds to what's going on in the world daily with a cartoon or a comic strip or an image, and I think that is very important. I was also excited about bringing artists that whose work is created to inspire, to motivate, and to ask us to participate in our world. And that there is a hope that if we're informed about things and find a way to participate, that we can really produce some change. And that was really essential to get that message across to our students. So without any further ado, we're going to start with Chikle, and then we're going to go to Lalo. And just one thing, I just wanted to thank Pat Vine, our gallery coordinator, who's so wonderful and helps me with all the details to put together our exhibitions. Our wonderful museum studies class, the class works with me in hanging the exhibitions and attending to all the details. And I think this time, because we had those little foldable books, they folded like 1,000 of those books. So I really appreciate all your work and your dedication. And I also wanted to thank the Humanities Institute and Dennis Rogers, because they also helped fund a portion of this exhibition. So now let me introduce Chikle.
Well, thank you everyone for coming out. I think it's amazing to have this opportunity to show with the artists that are in the gallery, all in one space, all at one time, in San Diego. I don't remember a time when that's happened yet. So it's really special for me to be a part of this show, especially because in 1997, I was a freshman in college, and an artist came to present, and I sat in the audience, and I never thought that one day I would be presenting with him. So it's even more amazing. So I'm going to talk about some of my pieces, and I have a quick video. I'm from San Diego, and I went to college in, at Cal Poly San Luis Obispo. Came back to San Diego, worked in print shops for close to 10 years total, and then I just recently had the amazing opportunity to become a high school art teacher. So I get to work with 10th graders, and it's been, my first 2 months have been amazing. So again, like having this opportunity to talk to young people and adults alike about my art and what it stands for, what it means, is really like the greatest gift. For me, like sharing my artwork and having people look at it and talk about it, take pictures of it, is amazing. You know, more than selling a piece, it's about people seeing the work and talking about it, and hopefully talking about it with a friend and starting a conversation that leads to something else, some deeper knowledge or deeper learning. So this video talks a little bit about it, about that. I put it together for a high school class. It's really short, it's 3 minutes.
I don't wanna write this down. I don't wanna tell you how I feel right now. I don't wanna take no time to write this down. I don't wanna tell you how I feel right now.
I am Chikle. My real name is Enrique Lugo, and I was born in 1979. Both of my parents are immigrants from Mexico. My dad is from Guadalajara, and my mom is from Tijuana. I grew up in the neighborhood of Paradise Hills, where I now live again with my wife Selena and our two kids, Damian and Itzel. I've been drawing ever since I can remember. My first influence as an artist has to be my dad. He would draw and paint all the time. I remember he would sit in the kitchen and listen to music or a baseball game while he did his thing. The first piece that we worked on together was this attempt at painting Tweety Bird. Then in junior high, I met my second influence, graffiti. I would see graffiti every morning on my bus ride from Paradise Hills to Point Loma. At the same time, I started listening to punk rock in Spanish, and the combination of these two rebellious expressions sparked something inside of me that continues to motivate and inspire me today. But probably the most important influence I had growing up was the screen printing class I took in high school with Mr. Peterson. For 3 years in high school, I screen printed t-shirts and stickers for my friends and I, but it wasn't until I graduated college and came back to San Diego that I got serious about it. Mr. Peterson once again let me work in his classroom, and it was right around this time that I met the two artists that would get me to where I am today. Bob Rob Medina and Ricardo Islas. In 2005, I had my first art show with photographer Carlos Beltran at the Ice Gallery in North Park. Fast forward to today, and I have participated in over 40 art shows, mostly here in San Diego, but also in Sacramento, Los Angeles, San Antonio, Texas, and internationally in Italy and Mexico City. I continue screen printing today in our studio Taller El Marciano. And I've also started painting using acrylics and watercolors. Most of my artwork deals with social issues and commentary on current events. I try to use humor, but also like to be straightforward with my messages in an attempt to spark conversation and hopefully awareness and a new consciousness for the viewer and myself. I like creating images incorporating text or quotes that inspire and motivate. The most rewarding thing for me as an artist is seeing people look at my pieces and turn to their friends to talk about them. I don't believe we need to be talking politics all the time, but I do believe we need to be aware of what's going on. I feel that I do my part towards a better and brighter future through my art. I believe that art and music can be used as powerful tools in the active pursuit of positive change.
Shine your light for the world to see. Come on, black people. My dream will say, shine your light on the world. Shine your light for the world to see. My elders say, shine your light on the world. Shine your light for the world.
So, I think that did a lot of my talking for me. But like I say in the video, I try to do images that will make people react. When I first started out, I was trying to do images that would kind of make people upset and put messages kind of in their face and more for the reaction of what they would say and just really with the goal to get people to talk, you know. And then when my wife and I were moving into our first home, there was a space in the back that we kept calling the illegal, you know. And you know, most people know what the word illegal is used for these days, but our realtor kept saying, like, don't call it that, the bank might not approve your loan. So then we started calling it the Martian, then, because it's an illegal alien, right? So I use this kind of one-eyed monster, because to me that's what an alien is. So this is the Marciano, which has kind of become my second logo, because I use it so much. And it's just kind of a really friendly way of pointing it out, you know. People aren't aliens, they're not illegal. He often gets confused with a Despicable Me character, which he is not, but I use him a lot because one of the things I notice is the way vocabulary is used. A lot of times you hear the word illegal and you already are like, oh no, like we have to stop them, you know, or terrorism. Like, there were so many words used in the media and the radio that you don't even think about it and you're already like freaking out over something that's not even necessarily true. So this is one of my favorite characters. This is one of my earlier works. This is from my first solo art show. And I've always tried to do things with text to really engage people to look and read. And not that I know what people should think, but I kind of want to point people in a direction. And this was just getting people to think about being engaged and being involved. And Alessandra kind of pointed that out of the more, I think everything I do is about people being aware or becoming aware. And I might not be giving an answer to a problem or really an opinion to a problem, but just pointing out something that's happening that maybe people don't realize or people are unaware of. Or, you know, something that might be happening in your backyard and you just never notice because you're so busy. We're so busy working or watching TV or other things like Facebook or, you know, important things. More recently, I started painting, but still with the same themes of, you know, positive messages, images that hopefully will motivate and inspire. Because we have two kids, I try to make them kind of childish and fun, you know, colorful, so that kids will like them. So I always try to do things thinking of my kids and the kind of people I want them to grow up to be. So this piece here is titled Shine Your Light or Follow Your Heart. And just, you know, talking about not being afraid, you know, like the forest in the background. I don't know how well you guys can see, but it's supposed to be these scary trees, you know, like the scary forest that's out there, which could be an everyday in our lives, depending on where we are, and just following our hearts and knowing that if we have the good intentions, we have positive intentions, and there's not a whole lot of wrong that can happen. And then this is a piece that I did for a show that unfortunately didn't happen in Mexico City, but it was about the border and how we deal with border issues. And I feel like being here on the border with Tijuana, there's people that don't know which way to go. You know, like, we're not necessarily wanted here, and it's kind of dangerous. Well, at the time I did this, it was still kind of hot and heavy in Tijuana, and, you know, there's all this violence, so you don't want to go because it's not necessarily safe. So you're kind of torn between the side, you know, like, which way do you go? And that's something that I think people don't really think about. Like, you know, again, people are being blamed when they come over of stealing jobs and all these other things like healthcare and education. And but I think for people that cross undocumented, it says a lot about how desperate they are for a better life. You know, the fact that they're willing to risk their life for an opportunity. You know, these aren't necessarily criminals because of how they got here. So, like, pieces like this, and you guys might notice my little character on the top right, the little Martian, because they're everywhere. And then I draw a lot of inspiration from music. I'm always listening to music. I don't really listen to the radio much. So a lot of my pieces incorporate lyrics or just ideas that I get from a lyric. This one obviously is from a Bob Marley song. And even though I watch a lot of TV, I'm not very much for TV. I wish we didn't have one, but then I find myself sitting there for an hour or two. But I think as TV has progressed and there's more and more reality shows, and, you know, they're really entertaining to watch, but there's so many other things we could be doing with our time. So I always try to have these messages of, you know, like this one says, apáguenlo in Spanish. In English, that's turn it off or turn him off. So you see the guy being chased. And I just really think that the issue that I have with TV is you see so many people that believe everything they see on TV or they hear on TV. And you could apply that to radio as well. You know, I'm more for us finding our own answers and, you know, hearing something and then, you know, doing some fact checking. That's what the internet is for. You know, as I'm working with younger students, it's really interesting to help them, you know, search the internet. You know, how do you search the internet? How do you enter a search? So I just try to tackle as many things, and you probably don't get all that just from looking at the image, but hopefully by talking about it or coming to a presentation where I tell you about the piece, you hear that, and people start kind of thinking about it. Like, maybe you guys will watch less TV tomorrow. I don't know. And then again, with the TV theme, I am the remote control. The TV can be a remote control for some people, so beware. And then this one is from one of my latest shows, where I kind of went on with, you know, Facebook, and I don't know if it happens to you guys, but when you're in a public space and you're kind of overhearing conversations about, oh man, like, I have this many friends on Facebook, like, well, I have this many friends, like, and it happens to me. I have a Facebook page, and I can honestly say I probably really only know about half or less, you know. And I think we've become so connected socially and technologically, supposedly, we've kind of lost that personal touch of, you know, calling our friends or actually face-to-face talking to our friends. So I always question, like, how connected are we really? You know, and it's just the same kind of reoccurring theme of technology kind of being this monster that can consume us. And that's actually my last slide. So again, I just want to say thank you to Alessandra for inviting me to be in this show and everyone that helped with the show. I had to fold some of those booklets myself, and it was fun. It was fun. So thank you, everyone, for being here. It's been an honor to share with you.
Hi, I'm Lalo. I want to say Chikle stuff is awesome. He's got a really awesome name also. And I'm sorry I ran out because there was an emergency on Twitter. The debates were on tonight, and I'll explain more of that, the vice presidential debates, and someone was missing during the debate, and that was Mexican Mitt Romney. But I'll talk more about that possibly. So I'm a cartoonist. Sometimes I have to fill in the box. I'm a cartoonist. I'm a satirist. I'm a writer. Fine artist. For tonight, for this show, I guess I'm a poster artist, sort of. I think mainly my thing is my job is creating images and communicating. An idea, a political opinion, or just a joke sometimes. But I like to do stuff that's not pointless most of the time. Sometimes I just do stuff just to amuse myself because I have been doing political art for almost 20 years. I want to count, even when I was in high school, I did political art. I wasn't exactly sure why I was so pissed off, but I knew something was wrong. With the world, so anyway, I'll just go on. I just created this image, my vote calavera. Every Dia de los Muertos season, I kind of do a new special image, and this is just kind of sort of nonpartisan image that just says vote, simple. I enjoy having just blunt imagery. This is when I was at San Diego State, I was the editorial cartoonist for the school paper, the Daily Essex, and so I did about I shared the job with a guy that was really lazy and never showed up again for the job, so I ended up doing sometimes 4 and 5 cartoons a week, in other words, a daily during the week. Daily strip, every daily editorial cartoon panel. So I would do cartoons. Reagan was the president at the time. It was kind of like when Bush was the president. He'd always say some stupid crap and try to start a war or try to. So it was a really good time to be a political humorist and cartoonist because Reagan was just rich, like Bush. And so. I hope never to have to experience Mitt Romney after another, 30 days. That trained me to have a rapid response for cartoons. One of my gigs now is editorial cartoonist, and I do one nationally syndicated editorial cartoon a week in English and Spanish. For Universal Press Syndicate, and then I just signed on with the Huffington Post, and we're doing like a sponsored Lalo page, on the Latino Voices section, I'm like the cartoonist. So I because of the political season, I've gotten other gigs doing quick turnaround cartoons for El Diario New York, which is in New York. A website, a union website called The Frying Pan, which is, I think, for SEIU. So I'm also, I do my freelance independent cartoons, but I have no problem being a hired gun for a cause that I believe in, which is union rights and workers' rights. And so I'm in a union household. I'm a member of the Writers Guild of America, and my wife's a school teacher. She's a union member, obviously. So it's nice when an artist can get a patron like that to do a cartoon here or there, a cartoon or a piece of art. Anyways, I'm blabbing. Here's one I did yesterday. And this is what I totally thought of for online. It's a simple Photoshop trick, but it works with Mitt Romney. He's just great like that. He's hard to pin down. Here's Mitt Romney debating Obama, debating himself. Here's the number of eligible Latino voters is at a record 24-something million, but the number of people that actually vote is not quite that high. This is a little exaggerated, I think. It's somewhere around 40-50%, but of the eligible voters. But. In California, we allow driverless cars, but undocumented workers aren't allowed driver's licenses. And this is when the governor signed a bill allowing like the Google car to drive around without a driver, you know, automatic cars. But the undocumented immigrants still got to ride their bikes to work. I did this. This is not as purpley as it really is in life, but I did this poster for the Arizona Mexican American Studies Department as a fundraiser for them to just raise money for their legal defense. It's pretty straightforward. This is a cartoon I did for the Frying Pan website. They are against Prop 32, and these are the Koch brothers. The Koch-topus is a common image using both of these evil billionaires as a giant octopus that's sucking up everything. All the money, all the resources. I just did this one this morning, actually. Who are the super backers of Prop 32? It's actually people that back Prop 8. So there's a lot of people that supported the anti-gay initiative and that are supporting this Prop 32. And we call this cartoon an evil Clark Kent. Should be homophobic Clark Kent. This is from my comic strip, La Cucaracha, which appears locally in the Union Tribune. It's about a bunch of 20-something friends that live in East LA, and my model for it is a comic strip called it's two kind of like Doonesbury and a comic strip called Bloom County. I don't know if you've ever seen it, but they're political strips. Bloom County like does really crazy stuff, and it did when it was around, and so I try to push it a little bit. And in this case, put this taco cart guy, who is not the main character, but he's like the most popular character in the strip because everybody loves tacos, and he doesn't talk, you know, so that much, and he floats in space. This is an image I did for the Anaheim Police Department when they shot two guys, one in the back of the head. Unarmed guy in the Anaheim barrio, and I created this as a fundraiser. I just, you know, raised $1,000 for the funerals of the two police violence victims, and I got a lot of crap for it, but I did get to donate the money to the poor moms, because that's what this was all about, the police brutality going on in Anaheim. And I like it. You know, I don't have money to donate to things, but I will always donate artwork or my time to raise money for whatever cause. That's not too crazy. This is El Zutador. I just combined two things that I love, which is Zoot Suit and Blue Demon, so. This is a taco cart guy at the Olympics. Again, not an especially political cartoon, but I think it's pretty radical to have a guy selling tacos on the newspaper funny page because there's not any, you know. There's only one, and it's him. Here's a... Repent, bad art restorers. It's the restored Jesus in Spain thing. Yeah, that someone let that lady that restored the Jesus painting into the Basilica in Mexico City, and she went crazy. And she's like, pay me. She just went to town. It's really terrible. It's very offensive. Here's Dora. Here's Mitt Romney before he spoke to the Univision town hall. And you notice he got a little extra brown. And he also had said it, you know, if I was Latino, I would win this thing, you know, like, because we all know how the many benefits of being Latino in the United States. You know, you get free accommodations in Arizona, you drive through. Bad schools. Here's the NFL replacement referees. And Mitt Romney scores again. And there goes Obama down the scoring a touchdown. This is an idea I stole from Chris Rock, and I turned it into a cartoon. But he had said the after the Republican debate when Mitt, ¿cómo se llama? Clint Eastwood, yeah, the other old white dude. When he stood in front and talked to the empty chair, they said, Obama should have a chair that says Osama bin Laden on it. Empty chair. That guy. To avenge the attacks on our embassies, the USA should immediately bomb England. That's it. This is the September 11th tribute comic I did in La Cucaracha, and I show these examples of, like, you know, how sometimes you just gotta not say anything and just go commemorate, you know, and sometimes you gotta say something. Here's Mitt Romney, candlelight vigil for Osama bin Laden. And here's a cartoon I did the year after 9/11. Which kind of the cause behind 9/11, maybe. Here's the Never Forget, the Twin Teepees. The people, because this was like in the year after, this is on the 1 year anniversary of 9/11, when the kind of, you know, I'm treading dangerously here, you know. But the hysteria against Arabs and the uber patriotism, it was too much. It was a little too much of it, and people were saying this is the worst, you know, act of war that's ever happened on United States soil. It's like, well, not exactly, if you count the whatever 20 million indigenous people that died. I think that's a conservative estimate. In North America, so yeah. And the ladies know what I'm talking about. This is the Republican war on women, they want to get up all in, up in your business. Self-deport, self-abort, we're the party of self-reliance. Here's Bill Clinton at the convention. Here's Chris Christie, his speech. Don't forget to mention my name, Chris. Here's a guy running around at the Republican National Convention. It's not easy being a GOP convention minority seat filler. because, you know, he's like the one black guy they have to keep. They can turn the camera so that he can run behind the seat and get in that seat over there, and then they turn over here. And he's kind of... here's Mitt Romney, Eddie Munster. Here's Mitt Romney's money on vacation, on permanent vacation. Now, this came out after Romney said he wished he was Latino. And actually, I had made this come true already when they created the character on Twitter, Mexican Mitt Romney, who you can follow. It's at Mexican Mitt on Twitter. And he is he's pretty much a right-wing ranchero. And he's a billionaire goat farmer from Michoacan, Michigan. He's not sure. He is very hilarious. And he actually, he did miss the majority of the debate today between the vice presidential candidates because the Wi-Fi sucks back at the art gallery. But that's, you know, you should rise up and protest that. Anyway, his slogan is, I am the 1%. And he wears a golden sombrero. But you should follow him. He's very funny. And he has lots of songs and stuff on the Ahua. All gringos love Mexican Mitt Romney. I don't know. You can find about 2 billion photos of drunk white people on Cinco de Mayo wearing big mustaches and sombreros. I think that would be, that's like endless posters for Mexican Mitt Romney. They're great. Here's another one, American Exceptionalism. Actually, Mexican Mitt Romney has fans that make this stuff now and send it in, actually. It's really weird. And here's the Curiosity rover on Mars. Colombia, we're not just known for drugs anymore. It's the Secret Service scandal. I promise you, the president has a big stick. This is a quote from Joe Biden. This is Obama giving Dolores Huerta the Medal of Freedom, Presidential Medal of Freedom. I don't know if you guys know, but Yes We Can translates as Si Se Puede. It does. He stole it. This is the Dream Act girl. And I was explaining this to someone. I'm a big supporter of the Dream Act students. I think they're great. I think they put their whole lives on the line to, try to become U.S. citizens, or at least they are already productive citizens of the country, this is a poster I did for them. I think I did. This was my big Occupy Wall Street image that was used all over the country in rallies and marches, and I let people print it out online, and people were making sandwich boards with it, walking around, and. It's in a bunch of textbooks now, I think it won me a couple of awards also, but I enjoy the textbook checks that come in my P.O. box. That's like free money. But it's in a lot of, I licensed it in a couple of calendars, and so that's kind of good. This is also one of my favorites with Geronimo. Questioning the Arizona hypocrisy on immigration. That's Arizona. This was called Liberties on the Run, and I did this for the Arizona SB 1070 law. And I put it on my Facebook page, and some of my Facebook friends said, yeah, that's a cool image. Well, why do you have 3 pregnant punk rockers? uh, Then I put this image up with Governor Jan Brewer standing in front of this billboard. They said, congratulations for getting Jan Brewer to stand in front of your cartoon. I'm like, there's this new thing called Photoshop. I don't know if you've heard about it, but obviously I'm very good at Photoshop. And Jan Brewer, I have a website called pocho.com, P-O-C-H-O. It's going to be on the test. P-O-C-H-O.com, and you have to go. Victor is one of our top writers on the website, Wave Victor. And he wrote the classic story, Vicente Fernandez, to open mariachi-themed casino. Or is it Mexican-themed casino? Or
mariachi-themed.
Mariachi-themed casino. And this story has gone on. I mean, I can now tell, I mean, it wasn't really a hoax, right? It was just a funny story.
It's real.
It's, but now people believe it's real. They're like, I can't wait to go to the opening. I see people post online like, oh, this is going to be great. You know, where's it going to be? Is it going to be next to New York, New York? You know, and it's called Guadalajara, Guadalajara. Right? And but it's just amazing how satire just turns into reality. And it's shaped like it's shaped like a barrel cactus. And there's a sombrero, like, kind of brim in the bottom. And then there's hourly displays of machismo. And, you know, it's fun. It's a great place. I've got tickets to go. And I remember Jan Brewer poking her finger at Obama. So he did that cartoon. And then we showed, I think, Jan Brewer celebrating with her... Oh, actually, this is from the Mars rover. So no intelligent life on Mars. And then Jan Brewer wanted to be Latino too. So she went back to Guanajuato, Mexico, to connect with her family back there. She actually has some relatives back there. So she should moisturize more. I did this in 2008. It's just simple. It's like first black president. That's all, nothing. And then New Yorker kind of bit it, which is fine. And then I did this in 2008. This is in response to Fox News putting out stories saying that Latinos were so racist they would never vote for a black candidate for president. So I did the Viva Obama poster with him as Zapata. Well, this pissed off a lot of people, but it was my most popular poster ever. And the campaign almost used it. The LA campaign loved it. California campaign was like, yeah, it's kind of cool. And then the national campaign was like, black guy with a gun. No, we can't use it. So, and I just actually met Obama on Monday. At the dedication of the Cesar Chavez Monument in Keene, and somebody asked me, "Is he as pretty close up as he is?" I'm like, yeah, I guess, you know, okay. But he met my kids. We put my daughter as bait, my 8-year-old daughter. He went right for her too. It was really cool, actually. And I had a list. I actually wrote about this on NBC Latino. I had a list of kind of questions in my mind I would have asked him had I had more than that much time, you know, to talk to him. Which one of them was, hey, do you have one of these posters I want to do? Also, will you sign 20 of them for me? Also, could you get better drone pilots with better aim? Also, could you stop deporting so many damn people? I want to get drunk with Joe Biden. That was on my list. And a bunch of stuff. This exhibit was about political posters, I did this cartoon. One day I was really depressed about politics, and so I did this cartoon, the Che Guevara with the Nike swoosh. And it's gotten around quite a bit. It's been bitten quite a bit. I wish I had done that, because I grew up reading Mad Magazine, which really obviously screwed me up when I was a kid. And then I did do this, Paris Hilton as Che Guevara. people were trying to make her out to be some kind of a hero when she got arrested. And I was wearing this earlier, the Freedom Fighter. I licensed this to a lot of places, and actually they sold this on tote bags in Japan for some reason. I'm not sure why. The Japanese are a special people. They have different tastes. They're so ahead of us. So, but I was wearing the t-shirt in a t-shirt shop in East LA, and a little homie came up to me and goes, "Yo, that's a dope-ass Planet of the Apes shirt, eh?" I said, "You're so close, mijo." I'm almost there. I'm almost there. A few years ago, I did the original Votería 2008. I did these Lotería cards based on the presidential election between John Kerry and George Bush. And this is, I think, my favorite. It was George Bush, El Ex Borracho. And then recently, I did these Votería cards. And this is the slogans: our elections are now such a gamble, they might as well be a Mexican game of chance. And I did El Tea Party. His shirt says, "Don't step on my snake." And La First Lady, you can tell she's got the guns. El Presidente. Now, if you think it was great, if you think Obama's great militarily, then that's like killing Bin Laden, then that's why he has the bloody knife that the Valiente has. But if you think he's a brutal murderer for having drone strikes all over, that's why he has the bloody knife. So everyone's happy, okay? So. And the El Middle Class and El Bin Laden. Glug, glug. And there's the Republican edition. It's like bingo, gringo. Just in case you're unclear. I just got a hate letter from some guy that said, he opens his letter, "Hello, greaser. There, how does it feel? Because you wrote, it's like bingo, gringo, and that's a racial slur against white Americans." And I'm like, dude, gringo is no more racial slur than Yankee, right? Or, I mean, it doesn't, like, if you translate gringo, it doesn't mean, like, you know, guy with smelly armpits, or, you know, it doesn't have some meaning. Like, pendejo. We all know what pendejo means, right? Do I need to clarify? It means pubic hair, sorry. But pendejo means stupid person, but it literally means a pubic hair. So, I don't know, I guess pubic hair is not high IQ people or things, you know. But so gringo, they don't even know, you know, I mean, there's all kinds of origin stories on it, but it doesn't mean anything other than gringo, you know, the American. I mean, I'm a gringo. If I go too far into central Mexico, you know, they'll be like, "Mira este gringo," you know. And it was hilarious. So this guy just wanted to cry because he's so oppressed by all the mean brown people. So here's, our elections are now as colorful as Mexico's beloved board game. There's El Mitt Romney, is it Catrín? He doesn't smoke or anything, so he just has wads of money. La Ann Romney, she just has a sour look on her face. El 1%, El Paul Ryan. He works out, you know. And, oh, see? He's just real. Why does the devil need to wear a boxer short? Are those like those boxer briefs? Or what is that? And El Fox News. And Pocho.com, we do a lot of funny stuff. Actually, Mitt Romney had a trip to Florida. Our reporter, Victor Bayan, is there. He went campaigning. And he's actually he's very dark from all the sun down there, I guess. He had a great time. He's prepare yourselves. Victor, I'm sorry. Somebody told me that That is the worst Photoshop thing I've ever seen. Is her head coming off? Is that what?
I lined up the ears.
You lined up the ears, okay. So she's got an extra skull back here? Okay. Okay, now prepare yourselves. That you're sick. They're alligators in the moat, yeah. Oh my God. So Mitt Romney had a great time in Florida campaigning. There he is, so thank you. He's the most Mexican man in the world, you know. For those of you that don't know, his father was born in Chihuahua on a rancho, which is Spanish for Mormon polygamous compound. There he is, trying to prove his Americanness, so you don't think he's Mexican. And thank you, vote.
If you guys have questions for either Chikle or Lalo or both, please. I don't know if we have a handheld? No. We can just repeat the question. Question right
here. Can you explain the image with Jay and the Nike sign?
No, I cannot. No. I'm a Che Guevara fan. And that, like I said, that day, I don't even remember why I was depressed about progressive politics. It was just something was annoying me, and I think maybe, I guess the topic was somebody was commercializing some progressive political thing that used to be cool, and so the idea of Che Guevara with a Nike swoosh just kind of went with everything that was going on in my head about politics being sold out, and also about stuff like Che Guevara becoming a commodity, you know, like anything else, you know.
I mean, I'm definitely, I know who I'm voting for, but I think the whole thing is kind of a big show, you know, like a big wrestling match where you don't know who's gonna win, but you kind of do, and then you kind of don't, and there's always that little guy that's kind of invisible, you know, and I think as long as people feel like their vote doesn't count, that little guy will never really emerge from their little hole, and it's kind of third and fourth parties. So that's why that guy is saying vote, please vote. Even if you don't vote for any of those two candidates, like, vote anyway, you know, that's the only way those parties will exist and grow and become a factor, hopefully someday.
Did you both start out thinking that you would become, you know, artist, comic, cartoonist? What were your ideas when you were in college?
I never thought I would have these types of opportunities. I actually, when I was choosing to go to college and deciding what I was going to do, I told my parents I wanted to study art, and of course they told me, why? You're not going to get a job doing that. And I was actually talking about this today with a student that, you know, I'm actually doing art and I'm sharing it with younger people. And it, for me, it's a dream come true because it's really what I wanted to do from the beginning. But I almost feel like I wouldn't have gotten here had I started so early. But to answer the question, no, I never thought this would become such a big part of my life.
I'm really no good at anything else, so. I studied art at San Diego State with the emphasis in environmental design, and then I went to Berkeley for graduate school in architecture, because of that you better get a career type of thing, you know, but the greatest thing for me was just becoming educated and going to a place like Berkeley that just, you know, opened up my head and really allowed me in the campus environment to be super political and also to start to perform and do comedy and realize, like, wow, I like this. Architecture doesn't look so hot anymore. So, although I did work at Point Loma, brought it back to Point Loma. I worked at an architecture firm in Point Loma, and that was weird. So that helped me not be an architect, I think. Good fish sandwiches, yes.
Out of all the pieces that both of you have done, which is the one piece that you are the most proud of? And I understand it may not be on the slides, but could you explain that one piece and why you feel so strongly about it and why you're so proud of it?
Yeah, why are you so proud?
For me, it's actually one of the pieces that's in the show, and it's the one with the kid holding a teddy bear. And that's a picture of my son. And it's my favorite piece because the background, he actually helped me paint it when he was a year old. Actually, he wasn't quite a year old yet, but I sat him with me and he helped me. So it's like the coolest piece, and it's a one-off. So for me, that's like my treasure.
I totally would have yelled at my one-year-old. You're doing it wrong!
I taped off the area, so I had a plan.
Don't eat the tape! since we're on the family tip, I like, there's a piece I did with, put the Sotomayor one, is it?
Yes.
The one where the little girl's playing judge in her room, it's pink, and that's my daughter. I drew her because I was watching the Sonia Sotomayor Supreme Court nomination hearings, and all the Republican questioners were saying all this racist crap to her, and were so rude, disrespectful, and she was so badass, and she just, mopped the floor with them, that I got angry, and I came back around to cute and positive and fuzzy. And I saw that, you know, these people did not see that, you know, Sonia Sotomayor would be such a role model. She already was, I mean, but she would be an even greater role model to all these, you know, like literally, like I had a little brown girl, and that it would be so important, and they that did not exist, that was not important for them in their world. So, and those Republican inquisitors. So I drew her at playing judge with her little bear Pepito and her Barbie dolls and this and that, and Sonia Sotomayor's friend bought that one poster for her. And we actually came out on CBS News with the day that Sotomayor got confirmed, and I said, we're gonna send one to Sonia Sotomayor. I told my daughter, I go, sign it. She was six. She was like, no way. I go, I'll give you an ice cream. She goes, all right, what do you want me to write? So she signed the thing, and we sent it, and Sonia Sotomayor sent me a thank you note, you know, like just for doing the cartoon at all, you know. And I was like, don't you have more shit to do than to send me a letter? You should be busy doing court stuff, you know. But I have a cool Supreme Court thing. I'm going to try to use it to get out of some prison time.
I have a question. This is from Lalo . How do you deal with criticism, especially since your cartoons are so political? I imagine you get a, like that guy you were saying, he did hate mail and all that type of stuff. Have you just developed a thick skin where you just let it fly?
That's funny too, because I'm like the most thin-skinned person. And my wife laughs at this all the time. She's like, oh, you're so sensitive, but you're so brutal, you know? And I guess I have developed a thick skin because all the hate mail and the dumping from newspapers and even recently I've had a lot of trouble with crazy people on the internet. They are just with guys. My worst stalkers are male Chicanos. which is makes me sad, really sad. I'm like okay if like Tom Metzger sends me a daily hate letter with a damn a burning cross or something. You know, I'd rather have that almost than like these Chicanos get all amped up and like pissed at me for whatever. Oh, I use Latino instead of saying everyone's Chicano, as if, you know, Guatemalans are Chicanos, and you know, I'm too you know, in the tank for the Democrats. You know, whatever. They're just, I mean, things don't even make sense. They're just like, whatever. And recently, though, there was one crazy guy that is here in San Diego, the guy from City College. He writes on the blog at the Union Tribune, and he's taken my La Cucaracha strips, and I don't even understand this guy's like concept, but he takes my dialogue out, and then he puts his own dialogue in, and fortunately, it's as funny as cancer. This is not funny at all, and he's an idiot, and I don't know. It's the weirdest like criticism I've ever gotten. Like, if you just flip Alcaraz's concepts, you could come up with these righteous conservatives. Like, dude, just write me a hate letter like everyone else. Don't write like a 1,000-word essay on why I suck. Just tell me I suck. I would enjoy to hear that from him, you know. But people are getting loonier and loonier. And then another guy threatened to slap my head off the other day. I had to delete yet another person off of Facebook, man. So probably I spend too much time on Facebook. But I like using the internet to distribute all my stuff, so it's double-edged. But anyway, that was a mouthful. Sorry. Please ask him 10 questions now.
This is a question for both of you. Do you think that people are more informed, less informed, or about the same as they've always been when it comes to politics?
Personally, I think in a sense less informed, because now they're getting it the same information, be it wrong or right. They're getting it from so many different angles, and people are posting their own versions of the truth, and then people repost that, and a third person reposts it. So I think in many ways we're less informed than we should be.
Well, I think yes and yes and yes, sir. I mean, they are, a lot of people are really misinformed and do not discuss. I mean, it's hard to argue with people. I mean, people just follow me just to argue with me all day long. And I can't argue with them if they're talking fairy tales. You know, I just can't compare like my facts with their bizarre conspiracy theories. I mean, it's like, you know, we have schizophrenics in my family. I'm not making fun of schizophrenics. But, man, there's a lot of... I think the whole country is becoming... It's a big mental case, you know. So, on the other hand, there's so much information out there that, you know, maybe people are being lazy if they don't find the correct information. I think, you know, we all have brains, and we should be able to, you know, discern things a little better. I don't know where we're failing, but.
This is for Chikle. I want to know how important typography is for you. I've known, like, in your artwork, it's very abundant that you use it very well, and even your shirt, and your name's Dulce, it's candy.
I think it's very important because it's kind of how I started. When I first learned some graphic design, it was typography, so it kind of stuck with me, and all my work is very graphic, and I try to always have everything balanced and like clean fonts, and like usually my choice in fonts symbolizes something, so it's very important, especially because I always try to include text in my work, so it's one of the main ingredients.
If Obama's reelected, what do I want Obama to do for immigration, in relation to immigration? Well, for one, to keep cutting back on the unnecessary deportations and splitting up families, not deporting people without, not deporting, what am I trying to say? Not deporting people that don't have criminal records, like there's no need for that. But the other side is he can't do anything unless, he can't make the law, because he needs Congress. So we're kind of might be screwed another 4 years. So I don't know. Something's got to happen. But that's my little wish list. And I wish he would sign my stack of posters.
I know you guys both talked about raising a family, and I was wondering how your art, the approach changed before. You were a little more edgy, and then after, if it's changed at all, raising young children.
Well, I know I became more offensive because of my family. Because I have a bunch of little kids that have my sense of humor. It's brutal at my house. So
mine has kind of stayed the same. I think if anything, it's just become more colorful, and I've started using more friendly characters that are more kid-friendly, but the message and the purpose is still the same.
And I want to say also, doing a daily comic strip is different from postering on a wall or whatever, like I can't do, I can't have foul language or, like difficult themes, in the comic strip, because the comics page is stuck in 1955. So that's just a reality. Some push it or whatever, but me as like one of the few, Latino comics creators, I can't really go over the edge all the time. I'm already on thin ice, so that's just that. That's
how do you guys feel about issues of appropriation of images?
Oh, that's a good question.
I think more experience.
I think we're both big appropriators. It's funny. Like I've now come to a point almost where people are starting to appropriate my stuff, and I'm like, hey, stop it. it's funny, there's rules to doing it. There's kind of accepted, take for instance this shirt, you don't have to credit the Pez company. We all know that that's Pez or whatever, but and also, if you're making like a couple dozen shirts, the Pez lawyers are not going to come at you. And it's just like being a musician. You sample, you riff, you take wholesale, but you, at least to respect the work, you got to know where it came from. And, one thing is jacking a corporate logo. I don't feel guilty about it. Jacking someone else's work and riffing on that, you really should be like, give credit, and say, like when I jacked that the Chris Rock joke, it was such a good joke, I turned it into a cartoon, and I'm not going to pretend that I wrote it, I put Chris Rock, not that he cares, but that's kind of what you do. Like I did the pepper spray cop image on, I don't think, did I have one of those?
No.
In there? The pepper spray cop in up north that sprayed the students, I did the, I am the creator of the Tapatio, I forgot what did I call it? It's like a Tapatio spray bottle for cops on the move, and it has the Tapatio guy and then the guy spraying the pepper spray, And I just made a few posters of it. It actually went viral and global, and everybody wrote about it. And but I credit, just to be safe, put the Tapatio guy is property of the Tapatio company, just so you know. And if I get a cease and desist letter, man, I will comply. I don't got time to, be a rebel, jacker, it's not my thing. My thing is creating new images all the time. I will always create a new one the next day. But how do you feel about appropriation?
I agree with what.
I have a question, because a lot of the people in the room are students, and usually when you're young, you just put things out there with no idea where they're going to be 10 years from now or 20 years from now. You're just enjoying life. But you were recently appropriated for something that you did in the early 90s, the concept of self-deportation.
Oh, yeah.
Talk about who appropriated that.
Oh, yeah. I don't know if you guys heard, but you know, Mitt Romney and the Republican Party, their immigration policy is self-deportation, which, you know, make life miserable for immigrants, undocumented immigrants. They'll just leave on their own. I guess it's like a way to save money without having to deport them. They'll just leave on their own. So back, though, during the Proposition 187 days, a friend of mine and I, we used to do Pocho Magazine. We created, we were so sick of Governor Pete Wilson's anti-immigrant propaganda during Prop 187 that he actually had a group called Latinos for Wilson. So we said, we'll create a group that's even more conservative than that group called Hispanics for Wilson. And we sent out fake press releases that we were having a 10K border fun run into Tijuana. It was one way, and send us your sneaker size, so we'll give you a free pair of sneakers when you go. And we had a call for the banning of Mexican food as biological weapons, the banning of Linda Ronstadt's music as because it attracted too many Mexicans, and we called for the deportation of Chinese people to Mexico. We don't care where they go after that, you know. People believe this, actually, and Telemundo believed it and invited us, the group, to be on a national broadcast. In 22 countries, this show aired. I came out as the leader, Daniel Deportado. And we talked about self-deportation and the creation of self-deportation centers. Recently, I think it was February when Mitt Romney said and we didn't get caught for this. This thing aired all over. Recently when Mitt Romney talked about self-deportation, the New York Times called me and said, wait a minute, didn't you invent self-deportation back in 1995? I said, yes, I did. So they interviewed me. That article came out, by the next day, Rachel Maddow show called me and said, could you come on and talk about self-deportation? I said, of course. And so that was Mitt Romney appropriating my concept of self-deportation, and it really paid off, finally, after 18 years or something. But
you talked about being dropped from some newspapers, your comic strip, La Cucaracha. And now that the San Diego Union Trib has been purchased by Doug Manchester, are there grumblings here in San Diego?
I haven't heard anything. I fear that, you know, I don't know what, you know, I'm crossing my fingers. The LA Times dumped me in 2007 for like 36 hours, but the people, you know, my Cucaracha army came through and revolted and got me back in. But I hope that if that happens here, maybe the Cucaracha army in San Diego will come out, even if the light's on, and help me get back in. Because, like I said, there's me, there's a comic strip called Baldo that's like a kid's comic strip with Latinos in it. But that's it in the whole U.S. We're the only two nationally syndicated Latino comic strip creator. And then there's Canderville, my friend Darren Bell. He's got a Latina character in the strip. Who knows? I hope not.
Questions for Chikle. I noticed that on some of your images, you had WND on the TVs. were you referring to like, destruction of an individual or a society or culture?
It's actually for weapon of mass distraction, but I like your interpretation as well, because I think that's kind of what it does, you know, it takes some of your soul. But yeah, the WMD was for distraction, the D is for being distracted and not knowing what's really going on.
Yeah.
Well, thank you. Ser como el aire libre no más se pasa volando. Ser como la paloma también se pasa volando. Cuando llorarás esas palabras me duele, porque la vida es larga y yo la paso llorando. Ser como el aire libre no más se pasa volando. Ser como la paloma también se pasa volando. Ser como el mar también